Hey everyone, Patrick CK here. It's been a while since I made a 3D printing video. Part of the reason for that is because I thought my Maker Select V2 was out of commission for good, but I recently discovered a fix, although it may only be temporary. More on that in another video. When the V2 broke down, I started looking for a replacement. I decided to stay within the Monoprice ecosystem since I was familiar with how they operate. That being said, I still had some criteria I wanted to follow for the newer printer. First, I realized I've never utilized all of the print bed for any project, so the bed size wasn't as big a factor as when I chose the V2. Also, a smaller bed makes it easier to level and keep leveled. Speaking of which, I wanted a printer that was easier to again level the bed and keep it leveled. Maybe an auto leveling feature. Next, I wanted the printer to be faster. The 70 millimeters per second of the V2 is fine, but some prints feel like they take forever. A more compact design would really help with the limited space I have. Lastly, price. I still don't feel like investing $1,000 into a top tier printer just yet. I wanted to get a new computer first. Even though I told myself I'll stick with Monoprice, I was still curious to see what's out there. Looking through the ever-growing list of budget printers, it's interesting to see just how many more are available now since I bought my V2. Nevertheless, a few models from different manufacturers met the criteria I was looking for, but in the end, I still stuck to Monoprice and got their Maker Plus 10 Mini, also called just MP10. It ticks all the boxes, and at $270, it felt like a no-brainer to try out. A quick overview of the specs. The bed size is identical to the V2 at 200x200x180mm or 7.87x7.87x7 inches. It's only considered a mini because the full-size MP10's print area is more than twice as tall and a bit wider. The printer speed maxes out at 100 millimeters per second, which is almost 47% faster than the V2, so a nice bump there. Printing resolution gets a bump as well. While the V2 ranged between 100 and 400 microns, the MP10 brings it down to between 50 and 300 microns. Lastly, the extruder can reach temps of 280°C or 536 Fahrenheit. Again, an improvement over the V2's 240°C or 464 Fahrenheit. In this video, we'll focus on the assembly of the MP10 Mini. Then in part 2, we'll fire it up and see how good this printer is out of the box. So make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss out on that. It'll be interesting to compare the assembly process between the V2 and the MP10 Mini. Right off the bat, the box for the MP10 is almost half the size of the one for the V2, owing to its more compact size. Pulling out the contents of the box, we find the printer in two main pieces, sandwiched between styrofoam cradles, along with some included filament, the instruction manual, and a support brochure. Before we pop out the body of the printer, we have an accessories box tucked into a pocket built into the styrofoam holder. In here, we first find a really short power cable, then a Type-B USB data cable, and a 16GB microSD card. Then some replacement parts for the extruder, a bag of assorted screws for assembly, a bag of assorted Allen keys and a wrench, the two pieces that make up the spool holder, and lastly, a plastic scraper. Nothing out of the ordinary here. Let's crack this egg. We have two main pieces to assemble, just like with the V2, the base and the vertical frame. Unlike the V2, there is no separate power supply / control unit. It's all incorporated into the base, which saves a ton of room and makes moving the printer around much easier. But as we'll see later, this layout does have some drawbacks. Before we start the assembly process, there was one more piece hidden in the styrofoam crater, the touchscreen monitor. we'll put that aside for now. We definitely need to talk about the included instructions. While they are clear and succinct, they are missing a few steps, and by a few, I mean a lot. The very first thing you need to do that's not in the instructions is to remove this temporary brace on the bottom of the vertical frame, using the 2.5mm Allen key. I believe it's there to protect the frame and gantry during shipping. Next, we'll attach the vertical frame to the base using the M5 screws. I found it's easier to put the base on its side and slide the frame in place while you screw it in. These screws need the 4mm Allen key. One thing to be aware of is that for some reason they didn't secure anything in place, so the bed and printhead are going to slide around. So just be careful as you tip the base and vertical frame over. On the V2, anything that could move was zip tied in place, something that definitely was missed here. Secure the frame in place and put it back on its feet. Speaking of the feet, they are super sticky. Even on this smooth table, this thing will not move. Good marks there. Another major departure from the V2 is the single screw rod for the gantry. The rod itself is secured under the bed by these two temporary brackets. Just loosen them with the 2.5mm Allen key and the rod will drop down. Make sure to completely remove those brackets as they will interfere with the operation of the bed. Another word of warning, the screw rod is covered in grease, so you'll either want to wear gloves or use something to keep your fingers from getting greasy. But remember, this thing needs to be greased to run smoothly. It would have been really nice if they mentioned this in the instructions. Before we enter the rod, we need to unscrew the top set screw in the screw rod holder assembly, using the 2mm Allen key. You'll have to lift the printhead motors up a bit to get easier access to the set screw. From the top frame, slide the rod down the shaft into the rod holder. Twist the rod into place, making sure it slots into the cradle at the bottom. Twist until the horizontal gantry starts to move upwards. Keep twisting until the gantry motors clear the set screw on the rod assembly. Now you can fasten the set screw back in place. Next up, we're going to attach the screen. Flip the screen face down and plug in the data ribbon into the port on the underside. There's a notch on the connector to make sure it only goes in the way it's supposed to. Flip it back over and use the M4 screws and the 2.5mm Allen key to attach it to the front frame of the printer. Just be aware that these screw mounts slide inside the frame, making aligning the bracket and the screw a little tricky. So just be patient with it. With the screen secured, let's do a nice slow peel. You may have noticed by now that the print head assembly looks quite a bit different from the V2, not only in its design, but also how it attaches to the frame. No screws, the whole assembly magnetically attaches directly to the gantry support. There are three strong magnets and two posts that help line it up. Once it's in place, it does not move without some significant persuasion. I love how easy it is to remove. Now you have no excuse for not keeping the nozzle clean. The last thing we need to screw in is the spool holder. As you probably have guessed, unlike the V2, we attach the spool holder directly to the base in the back left corner. Like when attaching the screen, you attach the vertical brace to these mounts, and again, they move around as well, so just try to line them up without punching the thing. We're using the M4 screws and the 2.5mm Allen key. This and the screen mounts could have been implemented a little better. Anyway, after securing that, the horizontal piece slots into these cutouts, and hangs in place. I have a feeling my smooth spool holder mod will help here, since this holder is extremely basic. If you didn't see the video where I created and tested that mod, I'll leave a card linking to it above. In part 2, we'll see how the MP10's method of feeding the filament is a bit of a departure from the V2. Let's plug in some cables. This is where having the PS2 incorporated in the base becomes a little tricky. But since you'll only be doing this step once, it's fine. Unlike with the V2 where you had to plug in the data power cables into each motor, that's already done here. You only need to plug in the main three plugs into their respective ports on the side of the PSU. Each one is uniquely shaped, so you can't put them in the wrong port. It does feel like you need small hands to maneuver in this tight space. We have one more thing to plug in. Unfortunately, we have another cramped space in the back corner of the PSU to try to plug in our AC power. With enough finesse, you can get it slotted in. Again, I don't understand why this power cable is so short. It doesn't even make it to the bottom of the table to plug in. Now we're done with assembly. Putting the MP10 together felt a little more straightforward and simpler than the V2. I'm not sure if that's because it really was, or if my past experience helped make this assembly smoother. Nevertheless, out of the box, this printer feels way more solid than the V2 when it comes to the flex of the vertical frame. I think it's due to the shape of the trusses that make up the frame. This shape gives the frame inherent strength and resistance to flexing, unlike the flatter, folded pieces that make up the frame of the V2. One other thing that may have caught your attention, as did mine, is the use of rollers to guide different parts of the printer. There are 13 of these wheels strategically placed to ensure smooth operation. I think I prefer this approach over the gliding setup of the V2. If you don't keep the surface clean and the grommets lubed, those glides will slowly stop, well, gliding. The likelihood of these wheels sticking is much lower, but again, there are 13 of them, and if one starts acting up, it could adversely affect the print. But unlike the gliding design, it's extremely easy to swap out one of these rollers. In part 2, we'll fire this thing up and start checking out some of the features that pushed me to get this printer, like auto leveling and intra-printing bed adjustments. Then we'll print a few models and see how they turn out, and compare them to the prints from the V2. Until then, like and share this video so others can find it in the future. This has been Patrick CK. Goodbye.